and the winner of the Friend of New Zealand Award is James Cameron and Suzy Amos Cameron.
Beating a lot. Jim was down here by himself, driving around, falling in love with this place. Then I met him 25 years ago. I fell in love with him. And as it turned out, not long after we realized that we were getting pretty darn serious, he said, "You know, we're going to move to New Zealand."
That was about 20 years ago.
25 years ago.
Yeah, right.
And here we are. So we're not spending our time between California and New Zealand anymore. We are here full time. And yeah. And loving it. The first time I was here was visiting Jim on the set of Avatar 1. It would have been November of 08, and I trooped down here with our then little bitty kids, toddlers, and I had an infant, and I was taken from the moment I checked in to Air New Zealand.
Good plug.
It was so incredibly welcome. I got on the airplane with all these little kids, and they couldn't have been more welcoming, helping me along. And we landed, and the first thing that I really realized, after I realized I had fallen in love again, was the pride. Just how proud Kiwi are, from top to bottom. And then as I traveled around the world and I would bump into other Kiwi, and I realized there is this unbelievable pride that happens. And it's understandable for grown-ups to be proud of the places they come from. They acknowledge it, they appreciate it. But now we have teenagers. And regularly we have a house full of Kiwi teenagers. They are full of pride. They constantly talk about how happy they are that they come from such a beautiful, amazing place. And they talk about the environment. They talk about what they can do. They are our future, and they are proud. When we got our residency, I actually was traveling over here by myself at that point. And I came up to the immigration officer, and I handed my passport to him. He took it, he looked at the picture, he looked at me, made sure I was the right person, flipped through it, opened it to that very special page where the residency was, put a big stamp on it, closed it up, handed it to me, and said, "Welcome home." I might start crying, but I feel incredibly welcomed. And I do feel at home. I feel more at home here than I do in the U.S. And I am really proud to be part of this amazing team. And I really am looking forward to bringing whatever I can around helping with the environment, around helping with plant-based food into this amazing, amazing culture. So, thank you.
That's great, Debbie. Well, Susie's expressed our feeling beautifully here, and we are very very happy to now call New Zealand our home, our primary home. And, you know, I just want to talk about the tall poppy for a second, because I think, you know, certain people that come here from the outside that are very successful, maybe they have some money, maybe they come from a very sort of entitled and arrogant place like Hollywood, as a random example, might be thought of as tall poppies. And I know that it's meant here in a celebratory and slightly cheeky way. But, you know, we felt when we arrived here that we had to earn something. Because the thing that struck me when I first came here in 94, and that perception that I had then, which was quite instinctive, has been reinforced by years of living here and working here and working with New Zealanders every day. And it was the thing that first struck me was not the beauty of the land, which of course is the best anywhere. It was the caliber of the people and something that everyone seemed to have in common. So I think as friends of New Zealand, you know, and what this award means, if you think about it, we can call this place our home, we can strive to be a part of the team, and we will, and we'll redouble our efforts, but we can never have been born here. So in a way, we'll always have a little bit of that outsider perspective. And I think, you know, there was the old fish was swimming along, saw a couple of young fish, said, "Hey, boys, how's the water?" And they looked at each other and said, "What's water? You guys are in the water. You don't know how great you are." I mean, I think we're here to celebrate the greatness of the New Zealand spirit, the mana, the innovation, the leadership, you know, the drive, the independence, all of those things. But I think that as Kiwis born and raised, you can't truly appreciate how great you are. And sometimes it takes an outsider's voice to remind you. There's something profoundly, I mean, you're all different people, but there's something profoundly different from everybody else in the world that is the same amongst you. And it's a certain sense of duty to each other, that you're all part of the team, that you will sacrifice for each other. And that empathy, that aroha, that love, that respect, whatever it is that binds you together, and we hope to be as much a part of that as we can be, is really different, and it's really profoundly important. I think when you look, I mean, I've had, you know, I've spent a big part of my life in the United States. The last 4 years have been absolute hell, but it's only surfaced a lot of things that were there. The divisiveness, the chaos, the inability to function together. You know, and I'm just using that as an example because we're seeing it all over the world as well, but you don't have it here. Look, yes, look, everybody, you know, they'll argue with each other. There's different points of view. Of course, we celebrate that, right? That's a diversity of perspective. But it never completely dismantles and unravels that fabric that binds people here together and makes things like the COVID response, which is unique in the world among developed nations, unique in the world. You know, that is something to celebrate in yourselves. It's something that we aspire to. It's something that our children hold up to us every day and say, "Oh, don't do that. That's tall poppy. That's too bougie. Don't do that." You know, and it's like, so now I'm, you know, we've sold us all our stuff in California, and I'm driving a Kia. And I don't mean the Kia Awards. I mean like a Kia Rio. It used to be our housekeeper's car. I figured, all right, is that humble enough for you? You know, and our teenagers sit in judgment of us because they've, you know, they feel a part of this. They feel a part of this. And
they
while
they want to learn to drive it.
Well, they want to learn to drive anything. But, you know, this idea of the team of 5 million, I think, probably been beat to death. But I think it's important nevertheless. And I think it's not ultimately about the team of 5 million. It's about the team of 7 billion. We face profound problems as a civilization. And that spirit of sort of mucking in and taking responsibility for each other, that's going to get us through. It's going to get us through as human beings. And New Zealand can teach that to the world. New Zealand can lead by example. Everybody's always saying here that we're a small country. We're not a small country. We're a giant. And I just want to applaud you. I want to applaud us together for what you can do in this world, what you can represent in this world. So thank you. Thank you for this.
Thank you so much. Thank you, and congratulations. And thank you for your very kind and heartfelt words. I think there would have been, not many dry eyes amongst us. Tell me a bit about how much the connection with New Zealand means for you. We got a sense of it.
Yeah, well, I think that I did.
Yes, and I've set you off again.
Yeah, no, I mean, it really is, it's incredibly emotional for me because it is such a unique place in the world. And, you know, like you said, it's you all, everyone is so incredibly progressive. New Zealand is on the world stage now for so many reasons. It's been the first, I mean, Peter, you talked about it with me a couple of weeks ago. It's been the first on so many different levels. And I think you wanted to say something too.
Well, there are so many, I mean, we could go on for hours. I'm just continuously impressed and inspired by the people here, by the film crews that I work with, by the visual effects people, by the innovators, the technologists, and so on. I would like to just say that we have unlimited potential for the film industry in this country, and I think we've proven that over and over again. But to really achieve our full potential, we need to invest in the training. We have plenty of great creative talent, actors, writers, producers, directors, far, far above the normal per capita sort of occurrence. But where we need to invest is in makeup artists and riggers and electricians and dolly grips and things like that. We don't have enough crews to satisfy the major productions that could bring literally billions of dollars into our economy here. And that, of course, spreads out throughout the economy, throughout all the service sectors, transportation, restaurants, hotels, everything else when these projects come in. I'm not talking about bringing people in. I'm talking about bringing capital in and training up Kiwis, because in my experience, Kiwis can do anything. They just do anything. And teach them to be a dolly grip. It's no problem. And so to the extent that some jobs maybe become obsolete or people don't have jobs, we can teach them. So that's a place where we can have real growth. I just want to say one other thing that inspires me every day here, in addition to that long list and some of the things I was talking about, is the respect for Indigenous culture here. Is really unique. I was born in Canada. I lived a large part of my life in the United States. The Indigenous cultures are crushed. They have the highest teen suicide rate. It's unfathomable. And they're not part of the conversation. They're not part of the leadership. They're not part of the conversation. Their culture is not celebrated. We see the opposite here. I mean, and it's growing and it's ascending so rapidly. And as someone who made a little film called Avatar that's about the Indigenous wisdom keepers, it's not really about blue people on another planet. It's about all of our Indigenous wisdom keepers here on Earth. And to see a society that so embraces the Indigenous roots, the wisdom, the tradition, the language, and keeps it alive and keeps it vigorous. And of course, there's a long way to go. I understand that. At least a huge effort is being made by everybody to do that, and you don't see that elsewhere. Sorry, I just don't see it elsewhere. Mm. And that inspires me, and it inspires me to want to do better myself as a filmmaker and as a storyteller.
I do just want to touch on one area that you're both very passionate about, and that is predator-free New Zealand. Why do you think it's so important, and what do you think New Zealand's contribution should be to this cause?
Well, I think one of the exciting things is around predator-free, and it's something that we've been taking steps towards that on our farm in the Wairarapa for many, many years. And so every day it becomes, you know, that possibility becomes, you know, more tangible. And being able to reintroduce native birds into the bush, and I've seen with my own eyes what the pests do
you know, to the bush. And a big part of our farm actually is bush, and so I have taken long walks through there many, many times. And being able to realize that it can actually become a sanctuary where people can come, children can come and learn and see all of those native species. And we're also getting involved with the Tonganui corridors. So we'll be planting native trees, which will bring more native birds and more biodiversity into the land. And I think it's really about making the land, leaving the land better than you found it. And I think that that's been one of our goals just from the very beginning.
Wonderful. Well, thank you both for all the work that you're doing here and for being part of our country. We have appreciated your kind words this evening, and congratulations.